What's up? Time Talks Med here. Let's talk about the cervical plexus. The cervical plexus is extremely important because it's going to supply many structures in the head and in the neck and even some other muscles that we're going to talk about. Now we're going to talk about in a series of videos, we're going to talk about the cervical, the brachial plexus, the lumbar and the sacral plexus, and then we're going to talk about the intercostal nerves. So the way I want to explain this plexus to you all is go through from the very basic to innervation and then some clinical relevance. So first we're going to go through the topography, just talk a little bit about where those nerves come from specifically. Then we're going to make a scheme of the cervical plexus. And to make the scheme, we will first go through the somatosensory branches of the cervical plexus. We're going to go through the motor branches and then talk a little bit about the mixed branches that the cervical plexus contributes to. Now, don't get mad at me for simplifying it too much now, but here you see the very basic vertebral bodies and the spinous processes of the vertebrae, forming the vertebral canal. And within the vertebral canal, you will find the spinal cord. And here we see the spinal cord divided into the cervical segments in orange, then the thoracic segments, the lumbar segments, sacral segments, and then a tiny end, the conus medullaris, from where the coccygeal nerve goes out from. Each spinal nerve segment give off two spinal nerves, one on each side, and they leave the vertebral canal through the intervertebral foramen. Here they're super simplified. I know it looks like they're leaving from between the vertebral bodies, but they're not. They leave through the intervertebral foramen on each side. Once the spinal nerve leaves the vertebral canal, it starts dividing into the posterior branch, which innervates the back. It divides into the anterior branch, which innervates the anterior part of the trunk and the limbs. There's a meningeal branch that goes back into the vertebral canal to innervate the spinal meninges. And then there's a rami communicans connected to the sympathetic chain ganglia, or the paravertebral ganglia. But what's important now for this video is the anterior branch of the spinal nerves, because the anterior branch is what forms all the plexuses that we're going to talk about in this series of videos. So, cervical plexus formed by the spinal nerves. Which branch of the spinal nerves? The anterior branch. More specifically, the cervical plexus is formed by the spinal nerve number 1, 2, 3, and 4. Let's now go ahead and simplify this drawing so that we can actually make a scheme out of this. Now, what I want you to do is to grab a piece of a paper and a pen, and I want you to draw the scheme with me. And once you do that, I promise you will remember this much, much easier. All right. The first thing we can do is to connect 2 and 3 together and 3 and 4 together. Then we can make an extra connection between C2 and C3 here as well. The first branch that we're going to talk about now is a branch that's actually going to traverse this way. This is called the transverse cervical nerve. And the transverse cervical nerve is actually going to be important because it innervates the skin on the anterior aspect of the neck and the lateral aspect of the neck. If you want to be very detail-y about this one, you can also see that it actually divides into the inferior branch, which innervates the skin of the infrahyoid region, and a superior branch, which innervates the skin of the suprahyoid region. And from the superior branch, now this is very detailed, but the superior branch can have nerves that form a looping connection with the facial nerve superficially, called the superficial ansa cervicalis, supplying the platysma. Then posteriorly, we got the greater auricular nerve and the lesser occipital nerve. And the greater auricular nerve, which is actually consisting of C2 and the C3 branches, is going to supply the skin over the ear and the skin lying over the parotid glands. So it's also a somatosensory nerve. And again, if you want to be too detailed here as well, you do have an anterior branch for the anterior part of the auricle and the parotid region, and a posterior branch for the posterior aspect of the auricle and the parotid region. The lesser occipital, some literature say it comes from C2 and C3, and other literature say it only comes from C2. So we're just going to have that here, but keep in mind that this can be changed depending on the literature you're studying from. But the lesser occipital nerve is going to supply the skin of the occiput, as well as the posterior aspect of the neck and the actual lateral aspect of the back of the neck. Now, C3 and C4 will go together and form what's called the supraclavicular nerves. The supraclavicular nerves will go down and divide into the medial supraclavicular nerve, innervating the skin over the manubrium of the sternum. It will give off the intermediate supraclavicular nerve, innervating the skin of the infraclavicular region, and the lateral supraclavicular nerve, innervating the skin of the acromial region. These four nerves you see here are what's called the somatosensory nerves of the cervical plexus, meaning they're superficially located and they transfer information from mechanoreceptors, exteroreceptors, proprioceptors, and thermoreceptors on this body surface. So, in other words, these fibers take in information like touch and pressure and vibration and temperature and itch and tickle and pain. So that was the somatosensory nerves. Let's do the motor nerves. Now, C1 and C2 are going to give off branches towards one another. They're going to communicate with one another. From this connection, as well as from C2, C3, and C4, there are going to be branches going out called muscular branches. So the muscular branches are going to supply primarily the lateral, the deep, and the craniothoracal groups of the neck. So it's going to innervate the rectus capitis lateralis, rectus capitis anterior, longus capitis, the longus colli muscles, scalenus anterior, and scalenus medius as well. So all of these muscles are going to be innervated by the cervical plexus through the muscular branches, coming from C1 through C4. Awesome! The next thing that's going to happen is that C2 and C3 are going to extend outwards and then come together. And when they come together, they're going to form what's called the inferior root of ansa cervicalis. Another thing that's going to happen is that the 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, is going to go along the superior side of C1 as it goes towards the tongue to innervate the extrinsic and the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. So C1 is going to follow the hypoglossal nerve and then give off the superior root of ansa cervicalis. So the superior and the inferior root are going to come together and form a nice little loop. And that loop is called ansa cervicalis. And it's a very important loop. Why is it important? It's important because it's going to supply specific infrahyoid muscles. So it's going to give off four different branches. And these have to be in a specific order from the superior to inferior. I will just draw four lines like this, but the left one is supposed to be superior going inferiorly towards right. This order is important because there can actually be some kind of lesion that can affect some muscles and not the others. Alright, so what are these branches? So the most superior one, the first one, is going to be the omohyoid muscle. It's an infrahyoid muscle, so it depresses the hyoid bone. Then we got the sternohyoid, which depresses the thyroid cartilage. We got a branch that innervates the sternohyoid, and another one that innervates the inferior belly of the omohyoid. And if you guys are unsure about the functions of these muscles, I have a playlist for the muscular anatomy if you want to refresh your knowledge in that specific topic. Alright, so that's the ansa cervicalis, the cervical loop, or the deep cervical loop is actually what it's called. Now, the 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, is going to go to the tongue, right? Innervating the intrinsic and the extrinsic muscles of the tongue. C1 is going to give off two branches. Specifically for the ganohyoid muscle, which elevates the hyoid bone, and the thyrohyoid muscle, which is actually going to depress the hyoid bone, but elevate the larynx. Awesome! We're almost done now. We talked about the somatosensory branches, we talked through the motor branches, which consist of the muscular branches coming from C1 through C4, and the ansa cervicalis, formed by the inferior root from C2 and C3, and the superior root from C1. Some sources might say that the superior root come from C1 and C2 because of the connections between C1 and C2. The last branch is a mixed branch. What happens is, coming from C3, is a nerve called the phrenic nerve. On its way down to the diaphragm, it picks up branches from C4 as well as C5. technically the cervical plexus is only C1 to C4, but C5 is also important because it gives off this branch here. Now, if you look here, we have the C3, C4, and C5 roots coming together to supply what? All of this will give way to the most important nerve of all. This is the phrenic nerve. The phrenic nerve is the most important nerve, and the reason why is because it supplies the main muscle of inspiration. It's the diaphragm, so it supplies the diaphragm. Any type of damage to C3, C4, or C5 nerve roots, it can cause extreme damage. It can cause, if this isn't able to work, you can actually have respiratory arrest or respiratory failure. You wouldn't be able to inhale anymore. Notice that this is a mixed branch. Now, what that means is that the phrenic nerve contains motor fibers, it contains sensory fibers, and it contains sympathetic postganglionic fibers. And the reason why is because it has branches that supply some other structures as well, not just the diaphragm. So let's go through the branches of this one. So again, this nerve goes down and gives a phrenic branch, which provides motor innervation for the diaphragm. So the left and the right phrenic nerves innervates their corresponding ipsilateral hemidiaphragms. And this is the only motor branch. The other branches are sensory branches. So it gives off pericardial branches that provide somatosensory innervation for the pericardium. It has pleural branches providing somatosensory innervations for the mediastinal and the diaphragmatic pleura. It has phrenico-abdominal branches providing somatosensory innervations of the parietal peritoneum under the diaphragm down to the gallbladder and the pancreas. And it has sensory branches for the thymus. The sympathetic postganglionic fibers engage the diaphragm to a sympathetic response, so fight or flight response. Alright, so that is really all the branches of the cervical plexus that I wanted to include in this video. But now, what I'm going to do is that I want to include one more mini diagram, because we have to talk about one more relationship, and that is the relationship with the accessory nerve, the 11th cranial nerve. Now, we're going to talk about this in detail when we talk about the cranial nerves individually, but for simplicity, let's add the spinal cord and the brainstem. Alright, so first thing, the main motor nucleus of the accessory nerve is located within the medulla. In the medulla, there's a specific nucleus called nucleus ambiguus. And the nucleus ambiguus is very, very important nucleus, because from the nucleus ambiguus, you're going to actually have the glossopharyngeal nerve coming out of this, you'll have the vagus nerve coming out of this, and even the accessory nerve, but very, very specific here, the accessory nerve, the cranial part of it. So there's a cranial part of the accessory nerve and a spinal part of the accessory nerve. So from the nucleus ambiguus, the cranial part of the accessory nerve is going to emerge and is then going to go through the jugular foramen. What happens now is that most fibers from the cranial part of the accessory nerve is going to go with the 10th cranial nerve, the vagus nerve, to supply a lot of pharyngeal and laryngeal muscles, right? But some fibers are going to continue without branching. So what about the spinal part now? If we highlight the spinal cord segments C1 through C5, there's something very interesting that happens. If we take one segment out, so we're looking at a cross-section of one of these segments here, and I look at this, and you know that when you're looking at the cross-section of a spinal cord, you know that you have the anterior gray horns, right? Which is the cell bodies of the somatic neurons. Here is the posterior gray horns with the cell bodies of the sensory neurons. Then over here, we're going to have the lateral funiculus, and then we're going to have the anterior funiculus, or the anterior white column. And then we're going to have the dorsal white column, or the dorsal funiculus. Something very strange happens within this part of the cervical region of the spinal cord. Coming off the lateral funiculus, you're going to have those fibers going outwards and then moving upwards. And what happens is, the lateral funiculus of C5 is going to give off a branch that traverses upwards. The lateral funiculus of C4 gives off a branch that traverses upwards. The lateral funiculus of C3, C2, and C1 give off branches that traverse upwards. Now, why is this important? Out of this, If you remember, coming out of the anterior gray horn, you're going to have the anterior root of the spinal nerve. And from the posterior gray horn, you're going to have the posterior root coming out of it, going together, forming the spinal nerve. Why is this important? This little cord that you see here, coming up here from C5 up to C1, that cord right there that's running in between the anterior root and the dorsal root, this is called the lateral funiculus. So as it moves upwards, it's going to meet up with the cranial part of the accessory nerve to go through the jugular foramen. And when the cranial part of the accessory nerve, the remaining fibers of it, meet up with the spinal part of the accessory nerve, which comes from the lateral funiculus, when they meet up, they form the main accessory nerve. Now what happens is that from the anterior ramus of the spinal nerve, you're going to see some branches that emerge from C2, C3, and C4. So the anterior ramus of C2, C3, and C4, which are a part of the cervical plexus, they will give off branches that join the accessory nerve to then go to two destinations. One of the destination is towards the trapezius muscle, and the other one will go to the sternocleidomastoid. This is a very simplified scheme of the accessory nerve. We will talk about the accessory nerve in detail in a separate video. So that's really the relationship I wanted to talk about. It's the relationship between the cervical plexus and the accessory nerve, the 11th cranial nerve. Awesome. So that was everything I had for the cervical plexus. The next video is going to be about the brachial plexus. I really hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please put a like, comment, and subscribe. See you next time.